and Resurrection Church. How are you all this morning? It is a very happy day. We are so privileged to be here to praise the Lord this morning, and I'm so glad to see your happy faces out here. We have the parade right after services. I hope that y'all can join us there and make a difference in the lives of some of the people here on the island. Let them know that it is today. God bless you, and let's praise the Lord, okay?
Well, good morning. Good morning. On behalf of Pastor Len and Linda, I extend their love to each and every one of you. For those of you that may not know me, my name is Dr. John Tierno. I'm one of the associate pastors here at Resurrection. And in Len's absence, physically, not in spirit, I'll be bringing the word this morning. Again, typically whenever I preach, I pray first, so just indulge me for a moment. Father, I thank you. I thank you for the privilege it is, Father God, to come before your people, your children, to minister your word. Father, let it not be I who speak, but you who speak through me. I have prayed all week believing, Father God, that hearts are prepared as good fertile soil, that the word that you allow me to bring forth by the power of your spirit will be inseminated with your life, and it shall put down deep and abiding root, and in season, Father God, bear fruit that is glorifying to you. I thank you for the honor and the privilege it is to represent you here this morning. And the church said amen and amen. Praise God. Now, a little bit different lead-in this morning. Any idea of what the title of the message is? Thank you. Who said it? There you go. The call. Absolutely, the call. I enjoy the Celtic Women. That's the group that you just saw. It's a short clip from something that they did. And I happened to upon it quite by chance, and as I'm listening to it, it really kind of fit the message that the Lord gave me to bring this morning, the call. Now, again, you know, you listen to those words, and when I first heard them, I said, Lord, what do you want me to talk about? There isn't a whole lot there. They're kind of nondescript. We have a tendency in the church to associate them with only people that have an office, a pastor, a teacher. They have been called to the ministry. I think all of us can identify with that in some way, shape, or form. So as I prayed, the Lord really began to expand those two words in a tremendous, tremendous way, in a way that affects each and every one of us, not just those that come to the platform on a Sunday to preach a word, but to everybody that has accepted Jesus as their Lord and Savior. We all have a call. Now, I'd like to approach this from three standpoints. Number one, who is called? Number two, whom are they called by? And three, what are they called to do? Pretty simple. The who is really, to me, rather obvious. And again, in Ephesians 4 and 1, here's what we're told. As a prisoner for the Lord, then, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have. Now, what struck me as I read this, this is Paul, as a prisoner for the Lord. Now, that to me suggests that Paul, again, is in God's service willingly. It doesn't say a prisoner of the Lord, as if he was captured and held captive, but that he willingly. Sometimes Paul uses the words bondservant, one who willingly places themselves in the service of God. So Paul is saying this not out of duress by any stretch of the imagination, but with a zeal. I urge you. That's a very, very powerful word. I urge you. I encourage you. He's placing great stress on that, to live a life worthy of the calling you have. Now, let me put this in proper perspective. The greatest calling any of us have is answering the call of salvation. Let me start by saying that. As a teacher of God's word, I would be remiss if I didn't make that number one. So again, that is the greatest. But once we are called, once we accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, we confess him, We believe in our heart that Jesus is the Son of God who died and rose again. We all have a responsibility. And that responsibility transcends simply going to church. Unfortunately, so often we equate being a Christian with ritualistic activity. Going to church. I read the Bible every morning from 9 to 9:15. I pray before meals. I even go to Bible study in the middle of the week. I'm faithful. Great things, provided that your heart has a desire to seek Him. That's where it all begins. That's where it all begins. And that's really the message of the call. As a prisoner, I urge you. So who was called? It's really very simple. Paul is speaking to the church in Ephesus. We are the church, the Greek word ecclesia, those that are called out. We are the church. Paul is speaking specifically the church. He's not speaking to leadership here. This is not one of the pastoral epistles. This is a message to the church in Ephesus, all of us. So the who part is really very simple. Each and every person who calls himself a Christian is called. We have a calling. We each have a calling. Now, who did the calling? I think we all realize that all Scripture is God-breathed. So when Paul writes, he is writing under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, God, the third person of the Trinity. So the who is doing the calling, or whom is doing the calling, my English, am I saying that correctly? Whom is that the right way to say that? Who? Okay, who, whom, I think you all get the message. God himself is doing the calling. Now, again, I hope this captures your attention. The message is to you, the church, from God himself. Not from a pastor, not from a teacher, not from an evangelist, but from God himself. You are called individually. He has imbued you with his Holy Spirit for a reason. And that reason, brothers and sisters in Christ, is not simply to come to church. You don't need the Spirit of the living God to come to church. Let's not delude ourselves. What we need the Holy Spirit for is to minister the Word of God in truth and in power. That's why God gave us His Spirit, that we may go forth under His unction to preach the Word of God. We are so easily set aside into ritualistic thinking. Well, I go to church. Praise God for that. I am not in any, please don't misunderstand what I'm saying. But my prayer is that every Sunday when you come in here, what Len preaches, what I preach, what James preaches, what Daniel preaches in the afternoon, okay, in some way empowers you, energizes you, gets you focused to go out into the world. That's where our ministry should be taking place, not within the confines of this building. Jesus did very, very little preaching within the synagogues of Judea, Samaria, and the Middle East 2,000 years ago. He was out preaching the Word of God in the byways, in the highways of that area. That's our call. So we are called by none other than God himself. To do what? To do what? What are we called to do? Again, I just alluded to some of the things that we should be doing, but it's not the call. We're not called to go to church. The Great Commission, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, making disciples of all men. That is the charge of every Christian. Now, how we do that will vary. We're gifted differently. And here's something else I think we all need to be very, very sensitive to. Well, Pastor, I'm not gifted. You're gifted. Pastor Len is gifted. Pastor James is gifted. You know, the elders are gifted. No, no. Let's get that thinking out of our minds. We are all gifted by the Holy Spirit, each and every one of us. Now, if you wanted to ask me, Pastor, I don't know what my gift is, that's a completely different story. Now we can work with you. Now we can seek God to see how Miriam is gifted, how Lois is gifted, how Wendy is gifted, that gift may be brought to the surface and then used to the glory and honor of God. That's the key. But we are all gifted. You don't have to memorize Scripture to fulfill the Great Commission. You don't have to memorize scripture to go out and share the love of Christ. We demonstrate that every single Sunday here. Every single Sunday. It is so simple. We'll do that at the very end of service. I'm not going to get into it right now. But we are called to share the love of Jesus Christ with the world. Now, are you equipped to do that? Yes. Are you called to do that? Yes. Not my idea, his idea. Now, what does that require? That requires a yielding on your part to the presence of God in your life. You must yield to God. You must yield to the presence of the Holy Spirit. You must seek him. One of the most powerful prayers I have ever prayed is, Father, use me. Now, I learned very quickly, you got to be careful what you pray for. Because God took that very seriously, and he started using me. But you want to know the funny part about it? And I don't mean that in a comedic way. He started using me in ways that I didn't want to be used. You hear me? We have a preconceived idea of how God should use us. Well, I'm this, so God's going to use me that way. Well, I'm that, and God will use me that way. Well, that may not, in fact, be God's way of using you. So we must be very sensitive to the Holy Spirit in humility. Let me take the story a step further. I may have shared this with you, and if you've heard it before, forgive me. I was asking the Lord, use me, use me, use me. As most of you know, Miriam and I come from New York. I was walking on a street in Queens, New York, one very sunny day, very similar to this type of a day, this kind of weather. And I had been just like, well, have to be the preaching of God's word. Nope, does not. It could be as simple as laying a hand on somebody and saying, have a good day. It could be holding the door open for somebody. It could be a smile. We need to broaden our thinking. Do you sincerely believe that Jesus went about for 3.5 years constantly preaching the word? I don't believe that. Not constantly. He interacted with people. He embraced people. He loved people. He showed empathy and concern for people. That is ministering the word of God. That perhaps is more important than the actual word itself. But the attitude of the heart that births that word. We all, by the power of the Holy Spirit, have the ability to minister in that capacity. All of us. The question is, are you submitted? Let me touch on again a very touchy subject. Jesus should be both Savior and Lord. When we confess Jesus is the Son of God, who died and rose again, we are justified. We are born again. Our name has been recorded in the Lamb's Book of Life. We have a ticket to glory to spend eternity in God's presence. That, brothers and sisters in Christ, doesn't necessarily mean that you have made Jesus your Lord. Because if he is your Lord, he will lord over you. He will tell you what to do, how to do it, why to do it, when to do it, and who you should do it to or with. That's allowing Jesus to be your Lord. That is the line we must cross over if we are to answer the call. He must be our Lord. We must allow him to minister in our lives. We must trust him implicitly for situation, word, and outcome. Don't focus on the outcome. Don't. We as flesh-bound people are results-oriented. Well, I preach the word of God. I know the word of God. God sent me to this person to preach his love to them. But I didn't see any results. You see, this doesn't work. We preach faith. Hebrews 11:1 gives us a beautiful definition of faith. The substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Don't look for fruit. God will provide the fruit in his timing, in his season. You be obedient. The blessings will come through obedience, his word. That's where blessings come from. Not from the production of fruit. God produces the fruit. We can see the fruit in a person's life. As Pastor Len so often says, we are fruit inspectors, but we can't produce fruit. I'm a Johnny Appleseed, brothers and sisters. I plant the seed. God is the one that produces the fruit, not me. You hear what I'm saying? It's really that simple. And when you begin to look at things in that context, it takes tremendous pressure off of you. All I need to do is be obedient to God. He's already given me His Spirit. I'm imbued with the very presence. God tabernacles in me. Oh, hallelujah. He lives in us. If we would get our arms truly around that truth, God lives in us. Oh, hallelujah to the Lamb. He lives in us. I know what I was. I know what I'm still capable of. And at times it's not pretty. But He said, John, I'll be with you until the end of the age. I will never leave you, nor will I ever forsake you. Not my words, His words. Hallelujah. That's the key, guys. And you know how that comes? Seeking intimacy with God. I preached a message here a while ago. God has no favorites, but He has intimates. When you seek intimacy with Christ, you begin to understand how much He loves you, how much He has invested His life in you. He has invested eternity in you. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. Perfection died for imperfection. The sinless one died for the sinner. That is unheard of in the annals of history. It has never taken place. The greatest leader that ever walked the face of the earth could not make that claim. But Jesus did. And on the cross, what did He say? Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. The people who were crucifying Him, He said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Oh, good Lord. My goodness, we are called. That is the legacy we are called into. If we had a vision of ourselves the way Jesus has a vision of us, we would not be walking with feet on earth. We would be walking 3 inches up off the ground. Think about that. Meditate on that, brothers and sisters in Christ. If we had a vision of ourselves the way Jesus has a vision of us. A vision allowed Him to die the death of crucifixion for each and every one of us. Our perception of us would change dramatically because of Him. Brothers, I challenge you. Sisters, I challenge you to think in those terms. Get before the throne of grace and ask the Father, Lord, how do You see me? What do You think of me? It's one thing to read it in a book. But when you get down, face down before the throne of grace and ask the Father, heart to heart, Father, what do You think of me? Listen to what He shares with you. It'll change your life in the blink of an eye. It will change your life in the blink of an eye. The call is no longer a burden. The call is a joy. The call is something you embrace. You look for the opportunity to share the love of Jesus Christ. You can't do it alone, brothers and sisters. You can't. It was never intended to be that way. Jesus said before He ascended, He says, I will not leave you comfortless. I will send you one like Me. I will send you the Comforter. He will lead you into all truth. He will teach you. He will be your counselor. I'm not your teacher. My ordination paper says pastor and teacher. I bring the word, He's the teacher. My prayer, and I mean this with every fiber of my being, is whatever I say, you breathe before the throne of grace and you say, Father, I heard what Pastor John said this morning. Now You reveal that truth to me in an intimate, personal way, a way in which, Father God, I can apply it in my life and bring glory and honor to You, sir. That's my challenge to you. And more importantly, I believe that's His challenge to the church today. We have a church today and a society today that's in apostasy. It's falling away. We are ordaining homosexuals to the pulpit to preach the word of God. Divorce within the body of Christ is on the increase. We have aborted 54 million of God's creations in this country alone since Roe versus Wade. 54 million. You tell me there isn't a need for each and every one of us to go forth. There aren't enough of us. It was never intended to be that way. That were the case. Stop and think about this logically. If that were the case, then God would have given James and Daniel and myself and Len and Wendy the Holy Spirit. And he would have said, no need for the rest of you. You're not going to be about my business. But God said, the same Spirit that rose Christ from the dead indwells each and every one of you. The very presence and nature of God is in you. The Word is in you. The teacher is in you. The counselor is in you. What are we doing to glorify that truth? Thursday night, I spoke briefly about the difference between reality and truth. We live in a real world. But is it a world that is defined by God's truth? Stop and think for a second. No, you're right, sister, it isn't. By no means. Cancer is real. Abortion is real. Homosexuality is real. Divorce is real. Are they God's truth? No. They're not God's truth. We need to recognize that. We need to come out of the world. We need to come out of the reality of this world and step into the eternity of God's truth. When that happens, then you begin to move under the unction and power of the risen Christ. Then you answer the call. We cannot answer the call, brothers and sisters, bound by the reality of this earth. We can't do that. When you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you stepped out of time and into eternity. I hope you realize that. That's a truth, not my truth, it's the Father's truth. That's the call, brothers and sisters. That is the call. Are you worthy? Nope. Am I? Nope. I can't tell you how many times I've asked God, why did you pick me? And you want to know what? I'm not sure I could give you a viable answer, although at some point I may have to stand before the throne of grace and answer to God. But I know I am called. I know that. As screwed up as I can be, as sinful as I can be, I know I am called to preach the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. I know that. I know it here, not here. I know it in my heart because it burns in me. And when I don't preach the word, I get antsy. I get nervous. Something needs to release itself. There is no difference between you and I, brothers and sisters. You need to realize that. You need to pull down the wall. You need to open up the shade and let God be God in you and through you to his glory. That's God's truth. That's the call. It's not deep theology. That's not deep. I spent many years studying. I have a doctorate in theology. What I just spoke to you doesn't come from a study. It comes from the Word. It comes from spending time with God, hanging out with him. Do you hang out with him? Oh, that doesn't sound too good. It's not nice to hang out with God. Oh, yes, it is. Nothing wrong with hanging out with God. We hang out in front of the TV. We hang out with our buds. Hang out with God. Let me share something else. If this fits, fine. If it doesn't, that's fine also. Don't be afraid to go before God with nothing. Short your heart. We as a church are too verbal. I've got to be constantly saying something. I've got to be constantly praying. I've got to be constantly singing. The Word of God says, be still and know that I am God. There is power in coming before the throne of grace and saying, Father, I don't have anything to say. What do you have to say to me? Think about this, brothers and sisters. How much you say to God who created the heavens and the earth with his spoken word. He said, let there be, and wham, there was. How much can we say to him? Not that he doesn't want to hear from us. Don't misunderstand what I'm saying. But it is a time where you come before the throne of grace simply because he's there. Listen. God is like a radio station. He's constantly broadcasting. The question is, are we tuned in to his station? Are we listening to the still, quiet voice of God? Are we listening? When you listen, I guarantee you, because he guarantees it, you'll hear the call. You'll hear the call. You'll hear Jesus say, I've invested in you. I've given you my life. I have one question, one request, sister, one request, brother. Share that life with somebody. Share it with somebody. It doesn't require eloquence. It doesn't require a seminary degree. It requires a heart that has a desire to serve. It's not deep theology. It's not, guys. It's not. It's simple, straightforward, honest, life-changing. We prayed about a brother before. God took him in a New York heartbeat and changed his life like that. Changed his life from a life of selfishness and disregard for human life to a life that cries out, not for himself, how can I help other people? God is not a respecter of person. He'll do that for each of us in our own special and unique way. Maybe not that dramatic, but he will ask you, draw you, call you to preach the gospel, to answer the call. I'm done. I don't think I have anything else to say. I don't think he has anything else. I think he does, but for now he said basta. That's enough, John. Amen. Brothers and sisters, there is no greater satisfaction known to humankind, and I will say this unequivocally, than ministering God's word. The greatest, listen, I've got a list of things, awards, all kinds of stuff. I have never been touched so deeply as when somebody accepts Jesus, when you see the light of God go on in their eyes. There is nothing that the world can offer you that even comes close to that. And the beauty of it is, we all, by the power of God's Spirit, have the ability to do that, to bring glory and honor to him. Think about it. The Word of God says that when one comes to the knowledge of Christ, the angels in heaven rejoice. Wouldn't you like to be cause for them to rejoice around the throne of God? We can do that. We have the ability by God's power to do that. Father, I thank you. Lord, if there's anything I have said today that is in any way not your heart, not your will, not your word, Father, I would ask you to erase it and reap your truth. Father, once that truth is embedded in our hearts, I pray the blood of Jesus Christ to seal that truth. That, Father, they would be provoked in love and mercy to answer the call. That they would know that it is you yourself doing the calling to share your nature, your love, and your mercy with whomever you send into their lives. And Father, I would pray that they would enjoy the experience immensely. For in obedience, there is truly blessing. And the church said, amen and amen. So there's two invitations out there today. Let's just take a moment and then we'll